afternoon. Hello, guys. Good afternoon. Okay, before we start, any questions? Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So why you are dead? I'm dead. Yixiang, right?
So, yeah.
So I'm dead. Okay. Huh? Is that, that's very good flag, right? So any questions? So today I'm at home. So if there's any network issue, please let me know so I can restart. Yeah. Any questions? So actually you guys asked a very good question last time. Okay. So I think you guys are very special. This year, I mean, this term, you guys are very special. So because I have taught this course for many years, I thought I know everything. But after your question, then I really understand something. So which I thought I know, but actually I don't know, actually. I didn't understand very well. So that's TRB, right? So I think last time you guys asked me, say that if we have multiple level paging, then how to do TRB, right? So I thought I understand very well because I taught computer architecture before. And for TRB, this simple stuff, right? So we just store some mapping temporarily. Looks like very simple. But when we go to multiple level, then actually what we should cache in the TRB, actually that's a very important issue. I think I made a mistake. I told you guys for the different level, maybe we should also put those for example, for the first level mapping, we should also put that mapping into TRB. But in fact, we only catch the final mapping item into the TRB. So when we go to, we either go to TRB to find the mapping, or if we didn't find the mapping, then we have to go through the multiple level paging in order to find the mapping. So basically that's a issue related to the TRB. So yeah, I think that's one question I want to clarify related to one question you guys asked me last week. Basically, the question is, when we go to multiple level paging, then what should we put into the TRB? So which mapping we should put? For those middle level mapping, should we put them into the TRB? So generally speaking, we don't put, okay? So So I think I gave you a wrong answer last time. Basically, TRP is used to only cache the mapping from the virtual address to physical address. Now, if we go to the TRP, if we could not find the mapping, then we go to multiple level mapping, right? So you guys can go to the course homepage. I provide a YouTube video in which a professor from Georgia Tech discuss this issue for how to design TRB and so on. So after that slide, then you should fully understand this part. Okay, but the TRB basically is a kind of a management is belong, is a part of operating system. In terms of design, actually is a kind of a hardware design, okay, related to the computer architecture. Okay, so if you guys are interested, so please go to homepage, our course homepage in Blackboard, then look at this translation, look at that buffer. From there, then you can fully understand. Okay, so any other issues we should discuss before we continue? Can you guys hear me clearly? Can you guys see the my screen? Okay, so that's the first issue. I think at this moment, it's good for us to look at what we have done, right? So you can see that, maybe let me open. Let me open our assessment, right? So at this moment, we finish three labs. Okay, we finished three labs. We still have two or one, okay? It depends on the progress. But generally speaking, this part is related to some simple question, right? So in concurrency, we should give you some labs. By the way, this week's lab is related to Bonner's assignment 4. Basically, that's a program assignment related to the memory mapping. So in terms of homework, actually finish assignment 1, assignment 2. Then you guys are working on the assignment 3. Then project and Bonner's assignment 1, which actually is in our course, we put in the course page, we put Bonner's program assignment 3. We'll deal after our reading week, next weekend, right? So I hope you have, because during this period, you have nothing to do, right? So please do finish those Bonner's assignment and project, okay? Then assignment 4 has been released, which is very simple, related to the mapping, memory mapping. Then if you have any questions, please go to the tutorial. Then we do have a Bonner's assignment, which will be released by this weekend after tutor talk about this assignment, we will release the Bonner's assignment. Four. Okay. So in terms of assignment 4, paper-based and a tutorial, actually tutor was sick last week, so he could not release those content based on our schedule. But I think we do appreciate his effort because he was sick, but he finally deliver the tutorial, okay? But anyway, that's a current progress. I hope everyone follow on this schedule. Now, if there's any issues, please discuss with the tutor first about your grading and so on, yeah. So final exam will be the date will be announced very soon. Basically, this is open booked, and the duration is 1.5 hours. Okay, so we will after the university formally announce this, then I will put this here. Okay, so yeah, last time actually we finished TLB and advanced paging. So tutor also gave a tutorial related to the mapping. So I will not go through that again. So let me talk about another issue related to the virtual memory management. Then we will go to concurrency. Okay, so this is the final topic related to the memory management. If we look at our memory hierarchy, then basically you can see a pyramid here. So inside the CPU, we have register, but here we don't have a lot. Maybe we have several hundred registers. Then our ALU, those arithmetic logic unit, can operate based on register directly. Okay. We also have cache. I think we touched this topic a little bit. Basically, cache is a small memory reside inside CPU. Okay. So the performance is close to register if we can find the data inside cache. Otherwise, we have to go to the main memory. So main memory is a central part of our von Neumann architecture. So basically our instruction, our data will be stored into the main memory. Then CPU, when we process data or when we execute the program, basically we need to either fetch an instruction from the memory or we load the data from the memory, okay? Then we also have a storage. Okay, when we look at this pyramid here, so this pyramid means if we look at our capacity, for our register, we only have several hundred, for example, 128 registers. Okay. This is inside our CPU. Cache, we have several tens kilo, okay, for level one, because we also have level two, level three, right? So, but generally speaking, this can be megabytes, okay? Megabytes, okay, several hundred megabytes, for example, right? If we go to level three. Then when we go to the memory, then we have several tens gigabytes or several gigabytes, right? 8 gigabytes, 16 gigabytes and so on. So when we go to mass storage, then now we go to the terabytes. Okay, 1 terabyte, 2 terabytes and so on. So you can see this is why we call it a memory hierarchy. We have pyramid here. So on top, we have very fast register, but the capacity very small. Then when we go to the bottom, it become slow and slow. Okay. However, the capacity grow, right? You can see this is from, if we look at, maybe it's from several hundred bytes here, then we go to the megabytes, the gigabytes, terabytes. So in terms of process, okay, based on our Fendiman architecture, actually we have to put our code and the data into the memory. It's not only put, we also need to do the arrangement based on our memory layout, which is defined inside the process structure. Then we can properly execute our program and also process our data, which is put into the data section. Then also if we want to handle the dynamic data, then we go to the heap. Then if we call the function, then we go to the stack. The issue here is that inside our system is not only one process, we have multiple processes, okay? Then if we only have one process, then our life will be much easier, but the computer will become not very useful, okay? So to handle multiple processes, we discuss various issues. For example, in the beginning, we talked about scheduling. Then we also talk about the mapping, right? How to allocate the resource, how to do mapping and so on. Then one issue is that we may not have enough memory space to run multiple processes. Then one very natural thought is, how about we and swap space. Okay, so what is swap space? It's from our hard disk, okay, from our storage. For example, hard disk or SSD. So over there, we have a lot of space. Then basically, if we can have a area in our storage device, then this one, we can make it become part of our virtual memory. So we may be able to run more processes at the same time. Okay, so that's the general idea, okay, for this swap. All right. So you can see the idea is very simple. See, suppose, okay, our physical memory, this is our physical memory. We have four pages. We only have four pages, okay? So on disk, our hard disk, our SSD, we can have a swap space. You can see here, okay, swap space, okay? So basically, if we only use our physical memory, then if each process at least need three physical pages, okay, you can see here, suppose each process need three physical pages, physical memory pages, right? So you can see if we directly do this without our swap area, swap space, then basically we can only run one process, right? Because I suppose we have some assumption, right? Let's assume that each process requires three physical pages, okay? Then because we only have four physical pages, so basically we can only run one process. However, if we add a swap space from our hard disk, remember our hard disk, we have a lot of space over there, right? So we can have a partition. So from the partition, we see that this part is a part of our virtual memory space we want to utilize to extend our physical memory space, right? So work with our virtual address, okay? So you can see then if we add eight physical page, But this 8 physical page is in disk, okay? So this is in disk, okay? Then you can see actually we can run here, we can run 0, 1, 2, 3, right? We can run 4 processes at the same time. So the trick here is that basically we will run this each process. But if we don't have enough memory, then we will swap this process or those pages related to a process into our swap array. For example, for the process 3, you can see basically if this process somehow is not running at this moment, okay, then we will swap his memory page into the swap area. Then basically at this moment, we can run 4 processes at the same time. Okay, that's general idea, okay? Then with this extension, after we use this, our swap area to extend our physical space, now we can run more processes at the same time, okay? Then suppose the memory is full, then basically we can move the page to the our swap area, then make room for the new page, right? So basically inside our operating system, we have some page replacement policy. So this one will help us to pick up a page, physical page, then move this page onto the swap area, then pick up a new page put into, right? So when we do this, actually we need the hardware's help, okay? Machinery, right, in the system to support these swapping pages, okay? So basically, in order to enable this swapping, then in our PTE, we need to add a flag. It's called the present. So if this flag value is 1, that means this page is present inside the physical memory. Otherwise, if this page is 0, then this page is not in memory, but on the swap area, it's in the on the disk. Okay. So then the issue here is that when we access the page that is not in the physical memory, then we have to do swapping. Okay, so operating system need to swap the page from the memory, then to serve this page fault. Okay. So generally speaking, you can see that our page fault is like this, okay? So when we refer a particular page, our memory access is go to a particular page, for example, this page, we find out, oh, this page is not in memory. This page, basically, remember this present means, okay, this page already allocate, this virtual address page, virtual page already allocate into this process. However, this page is not in the physical memory. So we will go to swap area to get this page. So generally speaking here is when we access this page, we will generate a page fault, which is a kind of a exception. Exception, hardware exception. Okay. When you access a page, then if this page, the from PT entry, the value is 0, which means this page is on disk on the swap area. then we will go to handle this page. Okay, so basically operating system at this moment, we have to write a page fault handler. So this page fault handler will say, oh, you want to access this page, or this page actually is in which area, okay? Then which page on the disk, where is the location, right? Then we get the value, we get this page from the disk, okay? Then go back to our page table, find a free physical page frame. So we have to find a free physical page, right? Because we want to read a page from the disk. So during this process, you think about that, okay? If we don't have suppose I want to get some water, right? So if my cup is full already, then I could not put it, right? So I have to make my cup empty. So basically that means, okay, I have to find a free page frame based on this free page management. Then during this process, maybe I don't have a free page, right? So I have to do some eviction, evict some page to the swap area or to the disk. Then after I get a free page, then I put this a new page into it, then go back. Okay, then retry this instruction. Okay. So basically that's when we have page fault, we have to look at the PTE operating system. Okay. Then read this page into the memory. Then during this process, maybe we need to do the eviction also. Okay. So look at this whole process now. Now this is a complete story. When we do memory access. So right now everything is virtual address. Okay. So so first we get the virtual page number, then use the virtual page number, we look at our TRB. Then if we succeed, we already see we get the mapping, right? Then we check the permission, right? If we check the permission, say, oh, this permission is correct, we can do this access. Okay. Then we get because we see in our TRB, this TRB, remember our physical page number, physical frame number, PFN, right? So from our PFN, then plus the offset from virtual address, then basically we can get the physical address we want to access, then finally we do the access, right? So that's great, okay? If the permission is not correct, then basically that means a protection fault, okay? So we just issue an exception, then system will handle it, okay? Otherwise, this mapping is not inside TRB, so this part, we have to check our page table now. So we first go to our PTBR, which is a page table base address register. Then over there, then based on our virtual page number, then find the corresponding our PTE entry and address, okay? Then first get this entry, get our PTE page table entry, right? Then look at this entry, is this address is valid? Okay, so although we have a virtual address over there allocated to this process, however, we have to enable this, validate this address, this virtual address, right? So it's not every virtual page has been mapped into and to be used. Okay, so basically if this is not valid, then we will see, oh, this is segment fault. Otherwise, pass through the check, then now we can continue. Go to go to our PTE to check whether or not this is a permission. We have enough permission. If we have a permission, right? If we have permission, then we continue, right? That here, then we have to look at, okay? See, after we get this PT entry, because we go to the page table, remember our page, PT entry, this is what we are talking about, the PT entry. Now we have a flag to represent whether or not this page is in memory or on disk. If this present is true, which means, oh, this page is in memory, then basically we insert this into our TLB, this entry, right? In TLB, which means for this virtual page number, VPN, then now we can guarantee we already have this PTE. The next time when you access, you can get it. You can succeed, right? Then you can access this page. So otherwise you will see, okay, oh, this page is valid. However, this page is not in memory. So we have page fault, okay? So basically this is what we discussed today, right? We have page fault. So then we have page fault handled here, okay? So page fault handle actually is kind of simple. See, first we have to find a free physical page, right? So we find a free. So we usually have a free page, free page management mechanism. For example, we have a list in which we can find the free page. So if we find a free page, we could not find it, right? Then basically that means we don't have enough free page. Then we have to do eviction. Then we have to go through our whole memory allocation, then find the free page, uses the some policy, for example, LRU, then evict some physical page, okay? Then put those, after do the eviction, then basically we have some free page, then put it back into our free page list. Then we will read this from, because this page is on disk, right? So we go to the PTE disk address. So PTE entry now record this disk address. So use this disk address. This is our new page we got. New physical page frame, right? After we do eviction, either we directly find it. If we could not find it, then do eviction. We will find it, okay? Then we read the page from the disk, then read into this page frame, okay? Then we set up this as true, already in my memory. Then we set up this entry, our PT entry here. Inside our page table, we have PT entry. Then now we have to update, right? This PT entry, the flag is present, the mapping is for this particular PFN. Then we retry the instruction, okay? So generally speaking, operating system need to find a physical frame, okay? Then if there's no such page, then we have to waiting for the replacement to release some physical page. So we can utilize the page to use. In reality, actually, operating system will not wait until memory is in completed full. Okay, so basically, we will have some demo here. So swap demo, page demo. Then after we check, see, okay, from system, we say, oh, our free page now is, we have two thresholds, lower watermark, high watermark. So basically that's some number. So we look at, for example, our lower LW is low watermark, okay? Watermark, right? It's mark our water, right? So basically suppose we can have our lower watermark is 5, which means if inside our system, now we only have 5 or less than 5 free page. Okay, then we will start our page replacement algorithm, then do the swapping. Okay, then evict some page onto the swap area, onto the disk, then until we reach to this high watermark, okay, high watermark. So high watermark, for example, maybe is 11. So of course those number, you need to configure those number based on the system. Okay. So then we will evict some page then until we get this, reach to this number. Okay. So basically that's how it works. So this is a whole process for the memory management. Okay. So then if we look at the average memory access time, then we have to consider this page may not be in memory now. Okay. So basically, average memory access time is suppose that the page is in memory, then we can directly get it. So the cost of access memory. Okay. Then if this page is not in memory, it's on disk, okay, then we have to go to the disk. So the cost of access disk. Okay. Then we do have the probability not find the data inside our page cache. So basically this is average time is a TM, memory time plus the probability we have to go to the disk, multiply by the cost to disk access time, okay? Then for eviction algorithm, usually we use LRU, okay? This is the commonly used, okay? So we discussed this policy before. So in your assignment, that additional program assignment, we do include LRU policy, so you can directly utilize that to do the eviction. Okay, so we didn't ask you to implement that part. We just ask you to kind of like do some eviction and so on. You can call that function directly. So don't worry, okay? Tomorrow, tutor will talk about this and release the that bonus assignment. So I noticed there are some questions from the chat box. Okay, so I will go back to answer your question after I finish. So you can see that if we, each time when we do the replacement or swap, only for one page, then based on our locality, right? Suppose we see that this page one, if we need to access this page, okay, it's maybe possible we also need to access page two, right? So in this case, actually when we do this swap or replacement, then maybe we can do the prefetching. So although we want to access one page, then we may also look at the adjacent page, then load them into the memory together, okay? So if page two will be accessed later, okay? So based on our prediction. So this is a very common tactic, prefetching, okay? Another way is kind of we can pending our write, okay? Then later we can write them to disk together, okay? So the idea is very simple. So basically, suppose we can write page 1, 2, 3, 4 together, then it should be better than we only write one page. The reason is that for hard disk, usually the sequential writes can benefit. Okay, even for our SSD, actually, still is better for this sequential write. Okay, but see pending writes, they do have issues. So if we have a power failure, then what happened, right? So to handle this, usually we have journaling and to help us to record some metadata and do some logging. Then if we have a crash, then we know how to roll back to a particular state, okay, something like that. Okay, so that's advanced topic. It also is a very active research area. Still is a very active research topic in operating system related to how to manage journaling and so. Another issue is that, see, if we want to put too many processes into the memory, okay, memory can be oversubscribed. Okay, which means, see, memory demand, okay, exceed the physical memory space we have. Okay, then in this way, actually, we cannot run our process very efficiently. So remember, we do have a scheduling. If we have so many processes running at the same time, then after we do scheduling, then we run another one. Then suppose we don't have enough space, which means maybe we need to evict some pages to the disk. Then basically after we finish this, maybe when we schedule, for example, we have A, right, and a B. Suppose our memory, it can only hold either A or B. Then of course we also have a swap area. Okay, this is our swap. This is a physical memory. Okay. So oversubscribe means what? Means okay, suppose okay, A needed the whole space here. Okay. B also need the whole space. Okay. But we do have the ability to run both at the same time. Okay, so what that means? That means we can put B's, for example, B, right? B's page into the swap area when we schedule B, right? Yeah. Then later when we schedule A, then we will evict all pages for A, then swap all disk page into the memory for B. Okay, so basically we can do this, but think about that. So because the disk read is very, very slow. So basically we have this, we call throttling. So we will do this back and forth. So after we have many process, for example, if we increase our number of process to run, when we go to a particular number, then the total performance will be reduced. So this can be observed. Look at the CPU utilization result. So you can see the CPU utilization is very, very low. The reason is that we will do a lot of disk read and so on. So if you check, you find, hey, so we have a lot of disk read. However, our CPU utilization is very low, then you may think about, okay? So maybe we run too many processes. Then you may say, okay, I have to run so many processes. So my boss told me, so we have to run so many processes, right? So how to handle it? How to handle it? Okay, increase your memory, right? So boss, if you want to run more processes, okay? Purchase more memory chips, okay? So if we have a memory slot, free memory slot, then insert a memory chip then usually a large memory can solve this kind of issue. Okay. Okay, so I quickly go through. So I know I'm a little bit slow. So we finished swapping here. So basically the idea is very simple. We want to reserve some space on the disk. So we can move page from the memory back and forth. Okay. Then during this process, maybe we have page fault, which means a page maybe in swap area, then we have to handle this, move this page back. Then during this process, maybe we need to do eviction. Okay. So then how to handle this also is one of active research topic. Okay. So when we do page replacement, we may use the low watermark, high watermark, those very simple strategy to do it. Then use some which page to be picked up for eviction. And so we may use LRU. So I guess that's all for swapping. So this also conclude the virtual memory part. So I'm ready to answer your question. Okay. Before I answer your question, so let's have a 5 minute break. Okay, so we can talk about your questions after we come back. Okay, so 5 minute break. Okay, let's continue. So let me check the question. Yeah. Is that a possible? Yeah, let me process. Yeah, let me try to understand your question. Okay, so but the process will run much. What slow, right? So basically your question is see if we have swap area, process will run slow, right? Right. So one line, is this your question? I hope, right? So yeah, I agree, right? So if we have a I agree. Okay, so but generally speaking, so certainly this is a much slower than the we directly put the process into the physical memory. So however, we do have some mechanism to reduce this overhead. For example, prefetching, right? So basically when we run a process, we will load several pages, or we can have some prediction, say that maybe we'll run this process so we can load some pages for this process and so on, right? So in this way, actually you can reduce that overhead, right? So, but I do agree. Is that possible OS cannot reach the hardware? Yinhou, so you mean the hardware failure, or you mean, what do you mean OS cannot reach the hardware? High watermark. So you mean under the high watermark? So we cannot reach to, so what, can you clarify? So under the high watermark. So basically for all those, so this depends on our system, right? So basically we have an interrupt that can help us do scheduling, right? So we can utilize when we do scheduling and so on, we can check whether or not we have enough free page and so on. So generally speaking, interrupt can help us regain the control, right? So when we have interrupt, then OS will regain the control. Then OS will control everything. Then OS will look at, oh, this is a free page. Then I need to evict some page from some virtual address space. Then basically we can do it. So to answer your question, basically OS can always reach to the control the hardware. Okay, we do have the ability to do this. I think we talk about this, right? So when we talk about scheduling, we talk about this. So after we introduce hardware interrupt, then when we handle the hardware interrupt, then operating system regain the control, then operating system can do whatever they want. Okay. I hope I answer your question. Maybe this is not very related to the high watermark. So maybe your question is that we cannot reach to the high watermark. So you mean when we do eviction, we may not able to reach to the high watermark. That certainly we can do that, right? It depends on how many pages we evict. As long as we follow a particular policy, we see that, for example, I just want to evict 10 pages based on LRU. Then it's just based on this policy, it's just to evict those pages, right? So if we don't care the performance, certainly we can do, right? Because that's the mapping, right? Think about that, okay. So we have process over there. You see, when we do this kind of high watermark, when we do the eviction, specifically what we do, we have a page table. We have page table, right? So we will check the page table and look at the PFN, PT entry, right? Then we will see that this page should be evicted. So basically we just move this page onto the disk, then set this page bit to be zero. That's it, PT entry to be zero. That's it, right? So we can always find enough. How to address the swap space. So, swap space is not an issue, right? So basically, it depends on the configuration. Usually we will see that we will assume we have enough swap space. Because our disk is much, much larger than memory in terms of capacity, right? So we assume we have enough space to do swapping if we want, but it depends on the system. Maybe we can put a half space, half physical memory as our half physical memory capacity for the swap area. I think this, in terms of how big for the swap area, then this is a kind of implementation issue, the system issue, right? So we only talk about concept. Then for the different system, you may have different configuration. Then in reality, you have to check your system, right? So even we have some general rule, but still you have to look at your system and then look at your workload, then your page, your usage statistic, and then you decide which policy you use. You mean how to locate the page in hard disk? So that's very simple, right? So you just usually we have a partition, so which means we will not go through the file system. So basically, we will have a kind of, you know, so what I'm seeing that, so I think the question is that, so swap area, how to decide the swap, how to manage this swap area, right? So basically, in hardware, we can have a partition, which means some physical blocks or sectors. So this part of the area will be utilized for the swap area. Okay. Then how to do mapping is a kind of we have a simple policy, you can do that, right? So basically we just record the free page, because here, this is here the unit also is memory, our page size. Right? Then we have some free page, then you just look at the free page in the swap app area, then find a free page over there, then do some eviction, do some replacement and so. Then our assumption is that this disk space is big enough. As long as you want to do the swap, then we have free page. Now how to manage is very simple, just use a free page list and so on. Yeah, so for example, we just have free page. Then this free page relate to a particular physical location. Then you just go there to find this free page. That's it. I hope I answer your question. Yes, certainly the address, right? So we have to know the address put into the PT entry. Otherwise, how can we find our page? If this page is in swap area, certainly we need to know this address. Okay. Otherwise, we cannot find it. You are right. Okay. So inside the PTE, so we have to remember this address in the swap area, right? In the swap space. That's it. Okay. So I hope I answer your question. Okay, now let's move to next topic. Okay. Yeah, okay. So, yeah, I'm at home, you know? So everything is just some, yeah, let me close the door. Yeah, I noticed there are more questions. So let me go back to answer those questions later. Discard. Somehow I should go to the desktop. Okay, so let's talk about concurrency. So this is our final topic. I hope at this moment everything goes well. If not, we still have a homework 3, homework homework 4, right? We have project, we have two additional assignments. So you have a lot of things to do in order to finally get a good grade, right? Yeah, so concurrency part, this part is difficult, okay? So it's not easy to understand. So basically, although we don't have a assignment question, we will put some related question into the final exam. Okay, so generally speaking, every year, we will have one question related to this part, concurrency, okay. So when we talk of concurrency, actually concurrency is not only related to the thread, but nowadays because we have multi-core, then multiple threading programming is a must. Okay, so basically we want to utilize thread to talk about concurrency. However, as long as we have shared data, we want to run multiple processes, then actually we need to handle concurrency issue. For example, inside the operating system, we have, if we have shared the structure among different processes, then basically we need to handle the concurrency. This is why this topic is put into the operating system. Okay, so anyway, so we'll use thread to talk about concurrency. Okay. Basically, this is a thread is a lightweight process. You can think about that. It's a kind of a new abstraction for a process. Okay. A multiple thread program has a multiple point for execution, multiple thread, right? Execution thread. Then we have multiple program counter, but they do share the same address space. So basically, each thread has its own PC and registers. Then inside our process space, we do have a thread control block. It's very similar to process control block. We do have a thread control block. Then based on this thread control block, then we can do scheduling inside this process, okay? Then when we do the switch from one thread to another thread, we have to store the register states. So for example, those program counter and those general purpose register, we have to store, okay? Then we have to restore because we want to switch to the thread two. So we have to restore thread two's register value, but the address space is the same. Okay? So you can see here is our address space. Generally speaking, when we talk about process, if we have new process, we have a new address space, which means we have a program called heap, stack, and so on, right? So when we have a thread, so you can see here, we have two threads to run. Then the difference is that we have same code. However, we have two different. Suppose we have two threads, okay? We may have multiple threads to run here. So then we have multiple execution thread, which means each thread has his own program counter and each thread has his own stack, okay? That's the difference, okay? However, all those threads share the code, share the heap. So this is why for thread, we also call it a lightweight process. Right. So because they share the same address space. So this is inside the same address space. Okay, so basically you can see the difference before, but when we talk about, we always talk about, we assume that we have process, right? Then our address space is here. Then we have register stack. When we do execution, we have program counter. We have a set of register. Okay, relate to this process. So if we want to create a new process, we have to have a totally new one, okay? So another mode is that, okay, in a lot of cases, for example, our HTTP server. So maybe we need to handle a lot of requests. Okay, after we have a request, if we just generate another new process to handle it. It may not be very efficient because we have to have a new address space. So how about we share the same address space here? So we have same code, then we just generate a new thread here. New thread means we will run the same code, share the data, share the file, then, but we do have our own registers and a stack, then execution thread, right? That's it. So in this way, actually, because we can share the code and data, then we can save a lot of physical space because this is very lightweight. So that's the idea. So we started with this program, right? In the beginning, we talked about concurrency issue. We show this program. So let me utilize this program to motivate you again for the concurrency issue. Okay. So later we'll talk about this API. Okay. But at this moment, you just think about, you assume that we can create a process, we can create a thread, use a P thread create. Okay. So the name is P1 and P2. Okay. We use the two API function, P thread function, create two process. As we mentioned here, when we create the process, all those processes can share the same code, right? So when we create a process, we need to specify which function to run for this process, okay? So basically here you can see for P1 and P2, we specify, we will run this worker function. Okay, this function here, see here, this function, we create a process, execution thread inside the process. Then we want to run this function, worker, right? Worker is very simple. You can see worker here. We have a local variable I. Then I from I to loops. Loops is a variable we will input. Okay, for example, 1,000, 10,000, right? It depends on our input. Then the program is very simple. Inside we will do a counter, counting basically. Okay, the counter in the beginning, initial value is 0. Then every time we will increment by 1, then we will loops times. Okay, that's it. Okay. So other part of the program is very simple. You can see that first ask the user input the number, then convert this into the loops. Then we create two process. This joined function basically means, okay, I want to P1 stop here and P2 stop here, okay? Then it's just the stop, okay? Wait, I want to, basically, I'm the main thread, right? I'm the main thread here. When we run this program, this is the main thread, right? This process, main thread, okay? I'm running, then I want to wait until, because I create this new process P1, right? I want to wait P1 to be finished at this moment. This is called join operation, okay? Then I also want to wait for P2 to be finished. Then after P1 and P2 both finished, then I print out the counter value, right? So basically that's the program. So summary, the main program create two threads. Then each thread is a function within the same memory space. Then basically each thread start to run in a routine called worker. Worker here, right? You can see this worker is very simple. Just do the incremental for the counter. Counter is a global variable. Okay, initial value is 0. So because we have two workers, suppose, okay, if we input is 1,000, because we have two workers, right? Each worker count 1,000 times, then our final result should be 2,000, right? That's clear, right? Okay, so however, if we put this a big number here, then we find out the result is not twice of this input number, okay? So then the worst thing is that every time we give this number, then our output is different. Every time it's different, okay? So that's very bad, okay? So what's the reason? Okay, let's look at how this works from the our von Neumann architecture perspective. So first, when we increment a shared counter, that counter plus plus, it takes three instructions. It's not one instruction, okay? It's three instructions, okay? First, we need to load the value of the counter from memory into the register because this is a von Neumann architecture, right? So we have to load the value from memory into the register, then increment the register value plus plus addition, right? Then store the value stored inside register back into the memory. So three steps, okay? When we do this increment, actually, because we have three instructions, then we cannot execute this in a atomic manner. So this causes concurrency issue. Okay, so let's go to look at one example, then you know what I'm talking about. Okay. So initially, suppose our counter, this is our counter, right? Stored in this address, okay? Then this is the one register, okay? So we first load the value, initial value is 50, right? Then we have two threads, T1 and T2 to run. Then after a switch, then basically the result is 51. However, after two threads to run, each run once, the final result should be 52. Then what happened, right? So basically that's the issue, fundamental issue. So let's look at our von Neumann architecture. So although this is a simplified version, but generally speaking, from architecture perspective, this current, our modern processor follow the same process when we do execution. So as I mentioned before, inside CPU, we have ALU, then we have a control unit here, we have a program counter, instruction register, and also process status register, right? Then we have some general purpose register that we can help us to store the temporary value from a memory we store, okay? So as we mentioned, our counter is stored in this address. Our program suppose is here in 100, in address 100, 105, 108, right? Okay, initially we run thread one, okay? Our initial value PC is 100, then our register value EAX, initial value is zero. Our initial value counter is 50 in memory, okay? So PC is 100, which means from our von Neumann architecture, remember, von Neumann architecture is very simple. Basically, we want to load the instruction from memory, do execution, then increment our PC, then continue, right? So basically, we have this instruction cycle, right? So let's look at, okay, 100, right? So next, because our PC is 100, PC is used to specify which instruction we should fetch from memory. Because it's 100, then we go to the memory address 100 to fetch this instruction. Okay, put this instruction into instruction register inside the CPU, right? Then we do decoding and execution, right? But after we do decoding, we find out, oh, this is a kind of a load instruction. Basically, we want to load the data stored in this address, then put the result into register EAX. Okay, so then we will do it, right? Do execution. Then we increment our PC. So for Intel processor, their instruction size are not regular. Okay, so basically maybe some instruction have multiple bytes and so on. So for example, in this here, we have how many bytes? 100. We have 5 bytes for this move instruction. Okay. So our next one is 105, next instruction. Okay. So we increment our PC correspondingly. Then basically, we load our next instruction. Our next instruction is 105. So we go to the 105 to load the instruction into the register, which will end one onto into the value stored in EX. So in EX, the value is 50, right? So basically, we will end one, so it becomes 51 in EX. Okay. Suppose, okay, we should, in the next clock cycle, we should load the instruction 108, okay, which is to store the value in EAX back into this address, right? Then we are okay, perfect. But however, interrupt occurs. Then maybe some students say, okay, oh, this is because interrupt occurs. Can we disable interrupt? So basically this is, you can see, disable interrupt, it may solve some issues, okay? But in under the multi-core environment, we cannot, after we have multiple processes, it's impossible to handle this through the only disable interrupt. We'll talk about this later, but generally speaking, you can think about, we have to allow interrupt occur. The interrupt can occur at any time, okay? So we cannot control it, okay? So interrupt occur at this moment. Because we need to somehow process the scheduler, say, okay, now I want to run T2. Then we have to save T1's states, right? Because later we need to restore T1, right? So then we have to store all those related registers. For example, in this case, we only store PC and EAX. In reality, we may need to store more registers. But generally speaking, the idea is the same. In order to resume the execution of thread one, we have to store some register state. So we, as showed here, we store here, okay? Thread one's local copy of PC and thread one's local copy of EX, okay? Okay, then because we want to run T2, so we have to restore T2's state. So for T2's state, we can see that thread 2's PC is 100 local copy. Thread 2's local copy of EX is 0. Okay, so we load those value into PC and 0, right, into EX. Okay, then continue. Our next instruction is 100. Then load it into the instruction register, then do the decoding. So this is a loading instruction. So load 15 into the EAX. Then next instruction is do the increment, then do it. Okay, become 51. The next instruction is store it back, right? Store value, store the value in EAX into this memory address, right? So we will store this into memory address, this address counter, right? Then finish. So then we should run next instruction, but however, okay, interrupt occur again. So basically we save T2's state. T2's state now is 113 and 51, PC and EX, suppose, okay. Then we go to the restore T1's state, which is you can see it's 108 and 51, right? Then basically we executed it because THX right now also is 51. So we replaced 51 with 51. So you can see here, because we cannot execute this increment in an atomic manner, okay, then our execution sequence can be in any order. So this is why we call this risk condition. So the result will depend on how we access our shared variable. Okay, for example, in this case it's T1. After we access this value, then after we get this value, we didn't store it. Then the final result will be decided. Okay, access sequence for this shared variable. So because each time the access sequence may be different, so we have different result. So this basically we call risk condition. Then we go to how to solve this. It's very simple because looks like this is a shared variable. Then when we want to access the shared variable, we need to guarantee this shared variable cannot be concurrently accessed by more than one thread. So we have to somehow guarantee the critical section can only be accessed in a mutual exclusive manner, which means at a particular time, only one thread can enter into this session. Okay. Then we finish. Okay. So basically, later we'll talk about how to handle it. Okay. So, but generally speaking, we'll use a lock. Okay. That's the most commonly used method to handle this. So, whenever we have this kind of critical section, we just put a lock and lock before we enter into a critical section and release the lock after we finish. Okay. Then we guarantee all threads when executed this lock, only one thread can enter into the critical section. Okay. Basically. Okay, so I hope I gave you a clear motivation for the concurrency issue. So next, I'm going to introduce some API to create a process. Actually, we already talked about this pthread, right? So when we do the pthread create, then so first, we will generate a thread ID. Then this one can be used to refer to that thread ID. The attributes used to specify some special attributes if you want to have relate to the stack size, schedulability, scheduling priority, and so on. So usually this part will be put as a known. Okay. Then which routine we'll use, which function we will use to run our thread. Okay. Then all those arguments relate to this routine. Okay. So basically this is a prototype. We have to follow this prototype, okay, when we call this function. Okay, to give you an example. So suppose in the beginning we define a structure in which we have two integer, then our pthread. So basically we declare a variable with this type, okay? Then assign the value A and B, okay? A is 10, B is 20. Then call this thread, then give this piece pointer. Then attributes, just put noun, okay, use the default configuration. Then which function we will use to run this thread, this my thread, okay? Then for this my thread, we have two, we have an argument we want to input. Then basically we just give the address of this argument. Okay, then inside this function, then we just simply get this argument, then print out the result. That's it, right? Basically, that's what we have here. The second part relate to this join operation. Okay. After we run this process, this thread, if we want to wait for a particular thread to be finished, then we can call pthread join, then put the thread ID here, then given a pointer type of pointer, then use contain the address. Use contain the return value, basically. Okay. So this part is a pointer to the return value. Okay. Yeah. So because this routine changes the value, okay, we need to pass in a pointer to that value. Okay. So I think here is a little bit confused. So what is a pointer? Right? What is a pointer? Right? So what are different? And so I will use the example to explain this later. Let's first look at how we wait, right? How we return the value. Then I will go back to this part to talk about this. Okay? So to make this program complete now. So basically now you can see this is our routine. We want to run this a thread. So for this input value, we just basically print out the value. Then we want to use a malloc to malloc some space in heap, then assign the value and the return. Okay. Then go back to one question. Okay. For thread, can they share heap? So for each thread, we do have a stack, right? So each thread has its own stack, right? So the question here is that for heap data, can they share the heap data? I spent a lot of time to do this animation, you know? So basically you can see here, okay? So from this figure, actually, I think we have process space, right? So you can see from here, actually our code, global data and heap are shared among all threads. So which means we do share the heap value, okay? So when we use malloc to allocate some variable, then actually inside each thread, we can utilize it, okay? It is shared among all threads for one process. Okay, so I know you guys have some questions, okay? Don't worry, I will go back to answer your question later. Okay, so as I mentioned, okay, the heap value will be shared. So this is why we can return. So basically you can see that I will first allocate in memory somewhere. Okay, suppose it's R somewhere. Then I will say X is one, Y is two. Okay, then I return this R's address, okay? So you can see here, the input here is that I want to create thread, use my thread, then input is this argument, okay? I give the address for argument, then basically go to there to just print out the result. Then I give this address of this pointer M, okay? Then basically utilize this one to contain the return address R. Okay, then through the through this M, then I can get the value correspondingly. Okay. So what's the issue here? Why we want to use the address for M, right? So what does that mean? Okay, so let me talk about this. Okay, so basically you think about it, okay. So in our as I mentioned, in our my thread, I do some malloc. Use malloc to malloc some space for in the heap. Then I return the address stored into R, right? So this is why Rx, Ry can be found into a heap. Then the value corresponding is 1 and 2, okay? So then suppose I put R here, R is here, okay? X, Ry, okay? So 1, 2, right? R is here, okay? So now we have a pointer M. Fundamentally, what is a pointer? Okay, pointer is suppose M address, okay, address of M is A. Okay, suppose, okay, because we have A here, suppose address is X. Okay, so this is X, okay. Then X value, okay, is a pointer, okay? So suppose the value stored here is y. Y is value, right? Y is here, okay? Okay, so at this moment, M is actually, M is just some value, right? I didn't give the initial value for M, right? So then when I see that I want to join, right? I want to wait for P to be finished, okay? Then the return value, return address, when we wait for P to be finished, when P finish, P will return some value. This return value will be stored into at M. Okay, could you tell me, okay? So the value will be stored into X or Y. Basically, if you understand this part, basically it's okay, okay? So see, only difficult part is related to this. So we have pointer, right? So pointer has two attributes. One is pointer's address, which is X, right? One is the pointer's value, which is y, right? For example, M is a pointer. M's address is x. M's value is y, right? So now I want to give at M, which means I want to see, I want to give the address of M, which is x, right? So what does that mean? Actually, I want to see that, okay, please, okay, I'm waiting for P to run, to be finished. When P finish, P should return some value. That value should start into X, this address X, okay? Do you understand? See, if you don't put at here, you put M. Suppose we put M here. What does that mean? So you will give the Y, right? The value Y, right? Basically, that means, okay, I give this address Y. Suppose Y is here. I'm sorry, XY is here. How about, I'm sorry, I didn't give a very good example here. So suppose the value is Z, okay? Value is Z. Okay, so in address X, stored value is Z, okay? Z is somewhere, suppose Z is here, okay? So if I don't give at here, then I will give M M's value is Z. So basically I provide the address Z here, right? Then the return value R will be stored into here, right? Oh, if I give the at, if I use at, which means I will give the address X, then you please, okay, when you return value stored here, replace Z, okay, with R. So this is why later I can use R to get the value X and Y, right? I know it's a little bit difficult to understand. Okay, so don't worry. Okay, let me first run this program. Okay, so let me first run this program. Then basically, you know what I'm talking about. I will show another example. Hopefully, you can understand this. So first, let me run this program. Before I continue, so can you guys see my virtual machine screen? Okay, thank you. Okay, so our program, this is exactly the program we run, right? So basically, we want to wait for this thread to be finished. So when we run this thread, our function we call is a myThread. So inside this program, actually, we just pass our argument, which is A and B here. Then A and B are passed as a void pointer. Then over there, I change this to my argument structure pointer. Okay, assign to this pointer. Then basically, I print out the value and return, right? So first, let's look at the result should be 10, 20, right? It's printed out, right? So I just want to first run this. So you guys can, then when we compile multiple thread related to the pthread, we have to include this hyphen pthread, right? Then when we run it, then we have 1020, right? Nothing special, okay? So how about 1-1? Okay. One is basically our program. Yeah, my internet is unstable at this moment. Can you guys hear me right now? Hello? Hello, guys? Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, yeah. So it's the first time. Yeah, we are very lucky. Okay, today. So, anyway, you can see here. So I think here actually is not the program I want to show you, sorry. So which one I want to show you? I want to show you two, right? Two is the program I want to show you. So basically, this is a program we showed to the slides. You can see, do the block, right? Then we give this address. Then we wait for this thread to be finished, then print out, right? Right. So basically the result is we print out in the thread. Then after we wait until our thread to be finished, then we print out the return address, return the value, right, from the M, right? So let me run this. This is a tool, right? Okay, you can see it return 1, 2, right? So as I mentioned, okay, this M is the address of M. So with this address of M, then when I return R, which is the malloc address in the heap, when I return this address, then we'll put into, suppose M, we only have two things, address and the value of M. Okay. Suppose address is X, value is Z in memory, okay? Memory address, okay? So when we go to the memory X, then we can find the M's value is Z, right? Okay, so this is why when we see that the return address, the return value will be stored into at M. At M means what? M's address, which is Y, okay? So then when we run this piece thread, we will return R. R is the supposed, okay, somewhere in heap, right? R is here, okay? We have X and Y right here, okay? So because we return the address of, we return R is the address, okay? So R will be replaced here, replace Z, the value stored in M, okay? So this is why when we go to R, X, R, Y, because R is here, right? R, X, R, Y, so we can print out the value, right? Okay, I hope next program can help you to understand this better. Okay, so actually this is a very similar, if we want to use M, okay? So this is another way to use M. So how about we directly use M, then what happened, right? So see here, I have another pointer, PP, right? Then I use M to store PP's value. So generally speaking, now I have PP is here, okay, somewhere, okay? So my M's value equals to PP, okay? M's value is PP, okay? So when I pass this M here, I can still pass PP, okay? But you can see PP actually is pointed here, right? This address, because M's value is pointed to the PP. So I really pass this value, right? This address PP to here, to this pthread join function. So return value R will be stored into PP, right? So R will be stored here. Okay, so this is why you can see the program will be something like that. We will use return PP's as PP's one, right? I hope this one can help you to understand what the difference between M and at M, right? If you use M, then basically you pass the M's value. If you use at M, you pass the address of M. That is the return value will be put into here. In terms of that pointer, basically it only tell us, okay, inside this pointer, actually we store the value is a pointer, something like that, okay. Okay, I guess that's all for today's lecture. Okay, I will continue to talk about this tomorrow. So I'm going to answer your question. And if you want to join the QA session, welcome. Otherwise you can leave now. Okay, any questions, please input your question into the chat box. Yeah. I will go back to answer your question. Yeah. Okay, I guess you guys may have a lot of questions, right? Yeah, let me just copy our question here. Okay, so today let me use Paint to answer your question, maybe. See whether or not I can make it work, okay. Hey, where is my
annotation here. So clean up here. Yeah, so I need to stop here. So yeah, so what's going on here? Okay, I'm copy the questions, okay? So can you guys see the question I copied in Paint? Hello, guys? Okay, yeah, yes, okay, thank you. Okay, so process will run slow. I think I already answered the question, high watermark. Some questions related to the watermark, I think we address those questions. How to address the swap space? I think we already talked about this. How to locate the page? Basically, we can do that in a simple way. Okay, put this into the PTE, right? Okay. How to determine least recent use? That's a very good question. Okay, I think this depends on the implementation. As I mentioned before, we can have a linked list, right? If we use a particular page, then we just move this to the end of the linked list and so on. But in reality, maybe we don't have a lot of space over there. So we can have some heuristic to do that. Okay, but generally speaking, we can use a method to estimate least recent use. Okay. Yeah, but linked list, right? Use a linked list to do this is possible. Okay. Right. So whenever we access a particular physical page, we have a list that just move this page at the end of the list, right? Is interval of interrupt regular? Okay, so yes, okay, it's regular. Okay, yes, it is regular. Okay, for example, it depends if when you set up a timer, you may have 100 millisecond or 10 millisecond. Okay. But I think your question maybe is see if this is regular, then we can determine the order. But it's impossible because after you have multiple processes to run, it's impossible to decide when interrupt occurred. Like you can determine when interrupt occurred. However, you have to determine when interrupt occurred, which instruction you executed, right? So that part is very difficult. It's unpredictable, particularly after you have so many processes. And inside each process, you have multiple threads. It's impossible to determine the location, okay? So thread scheduler. So that's a very good question. So basically the question is related to how to do thread scheduling, okay? So this depends on the implementation, okay? So generally speaking, concept-wise, thread scheduling should be done inside process, right? So I basically at the operating system level, we only do the scheduling for the process, okay? Concept wise. Think about the concept wise. OS will do scheduling, right? Process scheduling, for example. Then inside process, we can do thread scheduling, right? Okay, inside each process, for example, I allocate 10 milliseconds to this process. Then inside this process, we can decide how many milliseconds to allocate a particular thread and so on. But based on different implementation, for example, in Linux, actually, each thread is a task. Actually, this is similar to C similar to the process, okay? But in terms of the detailed implementation, please check the pthread implementation, right? So basically we have a pthread library to help us to do scheduling and so on. Yeah, so, but the concept wise, we should kind of do scheduling based on the process. Then inside each process, we have multiple threads. Then they do, we can at that level, we do the thread scheduling, okay? Based on some certain scheduling mechanism. So is there any reason why function must be void? The reason is void is great. So maybe you guys are Buddhist, right? Believing in the Buddhism. So void is emptiness, right? So yeah, that's a joke. So void means what? Void means anything, right? Void is a special type. Void is good. Void is good, right? Void means meaning. Any possibility is okay. It's fine, right? So this is why we can use void, right? So after we have void, then you can see that, oh, this void, then basically, because it's void, then you can utilize this void to make it become any type, okay? But except that, basically, I think when people define those function, pthread function, certainly they consider the needs when we call those functions. So they define those the prototype. Okay, I think I found some question, maybe I didn't copy here. Yeah, let me copy more question here. Yeah, so this is a very specific question. Should Yixiang ask the question, shouldn't it be my red star M here cause we passing the address of, so which part you are talking about? Maybe your question is related to, your question relate to the program, right? So this program here, right? So yeah, exactly. You can see, I think some student happy to answer this. So you can see M actually equal to address of PP, right? So it doesn't matter here. So you see the value is more important. This type is just that you can make a conversion to, you basically in C is very flexible. So this is why C is very, is used as a system level program language. Okay. So because C is very flexible, you can pass a value. But in terms of how to utilize this value, see, you can see that, oh, this is a pointer. Right? For example, you want to make this void star pointer only to make sure there's no error when you do compilation. But in terms of value you pass, you have to know which value you pass. Either is the address of M or the value of M, that's it, okay? In terms of type can be forced to be changed, okay? I hope I answer your question. Okay, so I think Kamlan asked, so it can be scheduled by user, right? So concept-wise is thread. It depends on the how we implement the thread. But generally speaking, if we can implement the thread library, then we can do scheduling among our, inside our process. Because threads are running inside the address space of a process, right? So basically inside this process, we can do the scheduling. So for example, pthread library. So we use the pthread library. Actually, pthread library should help us to do the scheduling. Okay, so it's by user level program. Yeah, because this is inside, right? One lamb said not a variable. So I don't understand this question. So one lamb, what do you mean not a variable? Huh? Maybe I already answered your question. Yeah, if I didn't answer your question, please. I mean, is there any reason why the function accept a pointer, not a variable? Oh, okay. So that's your question, right? I mean, is there any reason why the function accept a pointer, not a variable? This is related to either you want to pass the, but it doesn't matter actually. Yeah, so we do have some prototype, right? So we have to satisfy the function, the prototype. But see, when we pass a pointer, basically we pass the address, right? The address, we pass the variable. Basically, we pass the value we stored inside this variable, yeah, right? So I think I gave that example. You go back to look at that example, you can understand what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, in terms of pthread scheduling, okay? Sorry, I don't know how it works, okay? So maybe you guys do some research to teach me, right? So next time I can answer this better, but I don't know for the thread, how to do scan. I'm sorry, I have no idea, okay, how it works. But the concept wise, it should be happen at the user level. Okay, sorry, for some questions I could not answer. For other questions, I try my best. Okay, so any other questions? No more questions? Okay, thank you guys. That's all for today. I will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.